Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Everything She Touched, The Life of Ruth Asawa, by Marilyn Chase, narrated by Cindy Kay. Prologue. Auction, 2013. When the auctioneer's hammer came down, the winning bid topped $1.4 million for an 11-foot-long sculpture of wire mesh so light its shadow and substance seemed to merge. The delicacy was deceptive. Years of weaving such wire into gossamer globes had scarred the artist's small hands. Christie's May 2013 show, Ruth Asawa, Objects and Apparitions, was the sculptor's first solo exhibition in New York City in over 50 years. The evening auction at Rockefeller Plaza fetched 4 to 5 times the sculpture's estimated value of $250,000 to $350,000. Some people in the San Francisco gallery world had worried about putting Ruth's piece on the block, where it could disappear into private hands, out of public view. She belonged in galleries and museums that would display and not disperse her work, they said. But on the New York art market, it was a triumph. The record auction price for an Asawa vaulted the artist into the stratosphere. Christie's senior specialist of post-war and contemporary art, Jonathan Laib, was elated and convinced that Ruth's resurgence was underway. Ruth's children, raised to put creativity over commerce, were stunned. This was mom's work, one of many pieces she wove in her home studio, where her children also saw her cooking dinners and mopping floors. For as long as they could remember, her sculptures had hung from the rafters, sheltering their lives, casting moving shadows. Watching the act of making sculpture had expanded their world beyond the brown shingled house where they grew up in San Francisco into limitless realms of art. Far from their frenzied bidding at Rockefeller Center, the artist kept a lookout over her garden, a profusion of green she tended for most of her 87 years. She watched the windows for an emerald flash of hummingbirds that sipped nectar and wove nests in her honeysuckle. She had survived the Great Depression and World War II, slighted for her gender and interned for her race. She had toiled in the fields, the studio, and the classroom, elevating work to a form of Zen practice, her hands never still. Now arthritis had stiffened her once agile fingers. Fragile from strokes, she had spoken little in the 6 years since losing her life partner, the architect Albert Lanier. Together, they had lived without a blueprint and loved across color lines. They raised 6 children and fought for the education of thousands more. They mastered the art of shaping space, Ruth in sculpture and Albert in architecture. As their health failed, the couple had lived in hospital beds in the sunny room that had once been her studio. Her children knew best how to deliver the big news from the auction and how to read her response. Innocent of the previous night's bidding, Ruth looked bemused as her daughters Aiko and Addie drew close. When Addie whispered the sales figure in her mother's ear, Aiko watched her mother's eyes and mouth widen in wonder as if to say, "Really? Mama," Addie said, "you're playing with the big boys now." But it had not always been so. Chapter 1. War. On December 7th, 1941, faraway bombs broke the peace of a working Sunday. The Asawa family was working in the fields of their Norwalk, California truck farm. The family would soon fill sacks with farm vegetables as a holiday gift for the school bus driver. The simple offering embarrassed their middle child, 15-year-old Ruth. As she worked, she reflected on the coming Christmas break, which would not bring parties and presents, but the season for planting green onions, passing seedlings hand to hand, pushing them into the earth, and pressing the furrows closed in endless rows. Around noon, the rhythms of that life exploded in chaos. Shouts reached their ears in the field. Japan had attacked Pearl Harbor. The Asawas dropped everything and ran back to the farmhouse. Gathering around the radio, they listened to reports about the unfamiliar place now in flames, learning for the first time that it was a military base in Hawaii. As the chaos cleared and the attack came into sharper focus, Ruth's confusion turned to dread. Terror struck all of us. We wondered how our classmates would react. On Monday the 8th, our high school principal, Mr. Ralph Burnright, called an emergency assembly to make the announcement that the United States and Japan were at war, but assured the student body that Japanese students at Excelsior Union High School were not responsible for it. On the school bus, Ruth met hard stares. Withdrawing into a shell, she sought comfort from fellow Nisei, second-generation Japanese-Americans who, like her, were born in the United States. A girl in their choir class was bereft because her boyfriend wanted to enlist. But after Pearl Harbor, the Army rejected Nisei volunteers. The principal's speech briefly soothed Ruth's nerves, but her father, Umakichi, was uneasy. Born in Japan 60 years earlier, he feared being seen as an enemy despite devoting four decades to tilling American soil. After the bombing, his family took down the emperor's picture. Once as common in pre-war Japanese-American households as pictures of the king or queen in British homes, now it had to go. Any memento of his old country might seem suspicious. He resolved to purge his home of souvenirs like the kendo equipment Ruth and her older sister Lois used to practice Japanese fencing: a bamboo sword, body shield, gloves, and hakama, or culottes. Ruth watched him build a bonfire and feed pieces of his past life to the flames. To rid the house of any Japanese artifacts, he dug a big hole to bury the kendo gear and burned the hakama, beautiful Japanese books on flower arrangement, tea ceremony, Japanese dolls, Japanese badminton paddles. I still see Lois weeping and pleading with him not to burn them. He was afraid of being implicated. Days after Pearl Harbor, Los Angeles began blackouts. Reports of unidentified planes over the city drew anti-aircraft fire that awakened Norwalk residents from midnight to 2 a.m. as spotlights blanched the night sky. Enemy aircraft were never confirmed, but fear of an attack stirred anxiety from California to the East Coast. War inflicted differing levels of sacrifice on the home front. Families said goodbye to their sons. People adjusted to shortages and ration coupons for sugar and gasoline. The wartime hit parades spun platters like Rosie the Riveter and Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree with Anyone Else But Me. Japanese Americans faced a different reality. Slurs and menacing gangs that beat up anyone who, to their eyes, looked anything like the enemy. Some Asian Americans wore buttons to distinguish their origins. I am Chinese. Guides appeared on how to spot a Jap, promoting vicious racial stereotypes of yellow skin, buck teeth, squinty eyes, and shifty demeanor. More than 2,600 miles away, in Washington, D.C., President Franklin D. Roosevelt's administration feared that spies in the Japanese-American community were aiding Japan in an imminent invasion of the West. Hysteria drowned out any opposition, even from the nation's top cop, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover, who insisted there was no evidence of sabotage. Few listened. Politicians on the home front employed a chilling new term. Even before Pearl Harbor, in October 1940, Navy Secretary Frank Knox had handed Roosevelt a 15-point program to get ready for a possible war with Japan. The 12th point? Prepare plans for concentration camps. President Roosevelt himself used the term. The world hadn't yet come to equate concentration camps with the death camps of Nazi Germany that exterminated millions of Jews. But a clear-eyed view of history must recognize that what Washington originally planned to hold Japanese Americans, aliens and citizens, weren't evacuation centers for their safety, but concentration camps. Newspaper editorials calling for a roundup of Japanese Americans grew venomous.
Speaking as an American, I'm for immediate removal of every Japanese on the West Coast to a point deep in the interior,
declared Henry McLemore in a column published in the Los Angeles Times and the San Francisco Examiner.
I don't mean a nice part of the interior either. Personally, I hate the Japanese, and that goes for all of them. Let them be pinched, hurt, hungry, and dead up against it.
Cartoonists stoked hatred with caricatures of slant-eyed spies. In Waiting for the Signal from Home, artist Theodore S. Geisel pictured hordes of smiling saboteurs lining up for cakes of TNT to blow up the whole West Coast. The cartoon bore the pen name Mr. Geisel would later use on scores of his popular children's books, Dr. Seuss. Congress chimed in. All Japanese, whether citizens or not, must be placed in inland concentration camps, opined U.S. Representative Leland Ford, a Republican from California. Ford urged loyal Nisei, who were American citizens from birth, to join in and enter the camps voluntarily to safeguard the military security of their home country, the United States of America. Supporters of the roundup and incarceration of Japanese Americans included California Governor Colbert Olson and California Attorney General Earl Warren. Warren, the future governor, Supreme Court Chief Justice, and progressive hero of the 1950s, who helped strike down school segregation, called for putting people into camps by showing a map illustrating Japs in vicinity of strategic sites like airports, railroads, and dams. Conspiracy theorists held that Japanese American farmers could lay out crop rows like signposts, pointing the way for invading bombers to hit key targets. While a vigorous supporter of the Japanese exclusion during the war, a retired U.S. Chief Justice Warren would later voice remorse in his memoirs for the imprisonment of children. Roosevelt's cabinet backed the roundup with little dissent. Attorney General Francis Biddle opposed the action, but as a newcomer, he carried little weight. First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, a civil rights champion, appealed to her husband. The president listened coldly, but told her never to bring it up again. On February 19, 1942, Roosevelt signed Executive Order 9066, authorizing the removal of people of Japanese blood from a broad swath of the western United States that was seen as a sensitive military zone. The area included coastal California, Washington, and Oregon, plus southern Arizona. The program would uproot between 110,000 and 120,000 people, order them into assembly centers, and transport them to the camps. For many, their homes and property would be hastily sold at a fraction of their value, stored and later looted, or simply abandoned and lost. The American Civil Liberties Union would call the action the worst single wholesale violation of civil rights of American citizens in our history. Umakichi Asawa had come to the United States in 1902 at age 19 to avoid being drafted in an earlier conflict, the Russo-Japanese War. His life on American soil began with a desire to avoid fighting. He belonged to a farmers' association, sent his children to Japanese language school on Saturday, and took his family to a Quaker church on Sunday. He found bloodshed so distasteful that he tasked his wife, Haru, with butchering the family's weekly chicken. Neighbors couldn't believe that this lean, weathered farmer with the large, hardworking family could be a secret saboteur in their midst. The first wave of arrests began quickly and quietly, just after Pearl Harbor. The Asawa family noticed community leaders disappearing. The children's Japanese teacher, their sensei, was among the first to go. A new wave hit in February 1942 with the arrests of religious and business leaders, including local farmers. Two lawmen descended on the Asawa farm one day that February. Flashing their badges, Azumakichi knelt over his strawberries. The scene was seared in Ruth's memory.
Without warning, two FBI agents appeared looking for father. They went out to the field to get him. It was around 11:30 in the morning. They allowed him to eat lunch. My sister, Chio, had baked a meringue pie. We ironed him a white shirt, pressed his black suit, and away they went.
Ruth wouldn't see him again until after the war. Umakichi was raised in a very poor family in Fukushima province. As a young boy, he peddled natto, or fermented soybeans, from a cart in the street before sunrise, crying, "Natto, natto." But beneath his humble roots lay a powerful origin myth for the Asawa family, a name that is all but unheard of in Japan. The story goes that Umakichi's family was descended from the samurai class, and Asawa was originally Asano. Lord Asano was a famous 18th century retainer to the shogun, whose ritual suicide in a bloody court feud left his 47 samurai followers, or ronin, leaderless. The samurai from whom Umakichi descended sought revenge, which meant he also had to commit ritual suicide. But before taking his life, he sent his family into the mountains, told them to become farmers, and changed their name from Asano to Asawa. Ruth regarded this as a tale, savored in the oral tradition, passed down with a dash of skepticism. Umakichi fled Japan with his brother in 1902 to avoid being drafted into the coming Russo-Japanese War. After crossing the Pacific, they toiled in Hawaii's sugarcane fields and then crossed into the mainland via Mexico, eventually working in Utah's sugar beet industry, saving their money. In Southern California, they leased fields just off of Rosecrans Boulevard and built their own farmsteads. Like many a lonely immigrant bachelor, Umakichi wanted a wife. Families arranged long-distance engagements through the exchange of formal portraits with young women from home, known as picture brides. These betrothal pictures, the century-old predecessor of selfies on dating sites, were carefully composed to show prospective mates at their most elegant and eligible. A fiancé, looking sober and demure, might be flanked by her mother and sister, garbed in a fine kimono, her hair piled up in a glossy pompadour. This was Umakichi's first view of Haru Yasuda, the youngest daughter of a family that raised silkworms and wove silk for kimonos. She was actually the second candidate, an older sister first having backed out of his proposal. In 1919, Haru crossed the Pacific Ocean and landed in San Francisco. She met her fiancé, a seasoned laborer who was more than a decade older than her. And together, they boarded a southbound train to share a life of companionship bound up in toil. Seasons were marked by onions, broccoli, and cauliflower in winter, strawberries in spring, and tomatoes and melons in summer. Haru was following in the footsteps of many a picture bride, and more would come. Her older sister would soon arrive to wed Umakichi's brother, Zenzaburo. Home was a simple farmhouse in the small rural town of Norfolk, later incorporated into sprawling Los Angeles County. Umakichi built the board and batten house with its paper ceiling and tin roof. He built the barn and the garage. The spare shelter was graced with an encyclopedia and a player piano. There was little money for luxuries. Norwalk saw biplanes buzz its cornfields in the earliest 20th century. With a population of 4,000, its economy comprised farms, a blacksmith shop, a tire factory, and the Dr. Ross dog and cat food factory, which turned old horses into pet food and silver-tone soap. A three-bedroom house rented for $12.50 a month. A merchant's lunch cost 40 cents. As city fathers wooed commerce, Hollywood discovered the town's railroad station as a set for a movie starring Lana Turner. The postman always rings twice. But it wasn't always Hollywood glamour that sustained Norwalk through the Depression. It was the sweat of farmers like Umakichi Asawa that kept the town going. Despite alien land laws that barred them from owning the fields they tilled, Japanese farmers produced bumper crops. 40% of California's fruits and vegetables coaxed from 1% of its farmland. Umakichi and Haru were prolific partners in the fields and in the nursery. Their family grew to include Lois, George, Chio, Ruth, Bill, Kimiko, and Janet. Public displays of affection were rare, but their devotion was palpable. Haru gave birth at home and nursed each baby for 2 years, or until the next child came along. She carried her youngest on her back in the fields as she worked. Umakichi fashioned toy tractors from empty spools and rubber bands. The children were expected to be silent at meals. Youngsters asking questions were considered nosy and rude, but they were allowed to crawl into bed to hear their parents' stories. A jet-haired newborn, Ruth wailed her way into the world on the winter afternoon of January 24th, 1926, protesting expulsion from her mother's warmth into the chill. That's how she would remember it in wartime, as the world got even colder. I, being a winter baby, had an excuse to squirm and yell when I first made my debut. As an infant, I had my way or else. I rarely had my way. Making her way was an act of will. As the middle child of seven on a small truck farm, she stuck up for herself, but pitched in with the rest to help grow, pick, and transport produce to the Los Angeles farmers market. Ruth worked in the field and the packing shed after school, planting, harvesting, sorting, and crating vegetables from 4 until 8, when she turned to her homework until midnight under the watchful eye of her older sister, Lois. Perched on the back of her father's horse-drawn wagon was when she let her daydreams out to play. Dangling her bare feet in the dirt, towing in and out, she traced hourglass designs in the soil. No one watching the girl could guess that in those furrows, Ruth Aiko Asawa was planting the seeds of her future in art. The life of the Asawa family was forged in a frugality that put calluses on Ruth's hands, but never coarsened her dream of art. True to her astrological sign, an earth ox, she followed the Zen path of chop wood, carry water. Her American name, Ruth, recalled the biblical figure of family loyalty. Her Japanese name, Aiko, means love child. Her black bob framed a moon face that was often pensive, but her apple cheeks popped out when she smiled. She drew constantly. For her parents, tilling 80 acres and rearing 7 children took grit. Haru rose at 3 each morning to start the day's rice cooking in an outdoor pot. Umakichi was up at 4 to check his gopher traps and returned for breakfast at 6. Then it was back into the fields for work days, so relentless that visitors wanting a word with him had to catch up with him in the fields. For the children, walking a half mile to the bus and attending school was a respite from chores. For all their labors, the first generation Issei, Japanese immigrants, couldn't yet become citizens or purchase property. Their children, known as Nisei, were the first generation born in the United States, were classified as American citizens from birth. Amid California's history of white protectionism and anti-Asian bias, the state had passed the Alien Land Law of 1913, which barred Umakichi from owning the very land he tilled. Norwalk landlords who observed Umakichi's productivity agreed to lease land to him, and he made good by endlessly working, skimping, and strategizing. He enhanced his yields by saving his very best tomato, not to eat, but to pluck out superior seeds to grow next season's crop better than the last. Saving the best for next season became a habit. The Asawa sons and daughters joined their parents working in the fields every day but Saturday, which was devoted to Japanese language school. Ruth's other chief chore was to chop wood and stoke the fire under the family's traditional wooden bathtub, or ofuro, where they would line up their geta, platform sandals, to soak their weary bodies after the workday. After everyone had bathed in the ofuro, Haru used the warm broth of field dust washed off their bodies to sprout bags of seed before planting. Along with working the crops and heating the ofuro bath, Ruth repaired the thin wooden crates used to hold vegetables. She planted beans and trained the vines up trellises. All were solitary tasks that her parents assigned to their headstrong middle child to avoid sibling spats. The habit of incessant toil stuck with her for life. Nothing was wasted on the Asawa farm. Umakichi saved old nails and straightened them out for reuse. The family lived on vegetables and fruits they grew. 1 quart of milk a day for cereal, plus their one chicken a week. If a ripe melon cracked, the family ate it. On hot days, when Ruth sought shade under a water tower with Mexican farmhands, she got to share their tortillas, warmed over a wood fire. Umakichi was a truck farmer who drove his harvests weekly to the Los Angeles farmers market. In the Depression, truck farmers scraped by, getting a nickel for a box of tomatoes, 50 cents for 6 dozen radishes, 35 cents for a crate of cabbage, and 10 cents for a box of 2 dozen melons. Sometimes shippers would trick suppliers, contracting for all of the farm's celery and tomatoes, then packing it up and declaring bankruptcy. Growers rarely got ahead. Umakichi exhausted his savings in paying medical bills when his brother fell mortally ill, so the family's hand-to-mouth existence later included his brother's widow and children. For working the whole summer, Ruth, like all her siblings, got $10 to buy school wear. Maybe a pair of shoes for $1.95, underwear, and a couple of dresses. Umakichi was proud and independent. Ruth remembered sitting around the table, hearing her father read an article about a farmer who couldn't afford to provide for his 5 children. He took a shotgun to each of them rather than accept charity. Umakichi told his wife that he would do the same thing before he took a handout. The Asawa children, raised not to talk at meals, eyed each other in shocked silence. But for all their father's fierce pride, his children were never spanked. The Asawas attended the local Zen Buddhist temple for funerals and memorials. On Sunday, the family went to the Quaker church because it was one of the few Christian houses of worship that welcomed Japanese Americans. Ruth liked it, until one day, the churchyard pond looked too inviting. Leaning over the water, she lost her balance and fell in with a splash, drenching her clothes. Offered a change of clothes from the minister's son, she spent the service chafing in boy's garb and then avoided church until she was 15. Later, when war broke out, the Quakers would remain among the few groups to stand by the Japanese Americans. They were fearless people, Ruth would say. As the girl in the middle, Ruth fought for her place. With 3 siblings above her and 3 below, she stood her ground, saying, "I was bossed, and I was boss." Ruth's earliest memory was of fever. At 3 years old, she crossed paths with someone who sneezed or coughed, but it was no ordinary germ. Her throat grew sore and coated with a tough gray membrane that made it hard to swallow or breathe. It was diphtheria, a contagious bacterial disease known as the strangler. Before routine vaccination, it was a major killer, especially of young children. Sounds of discord reached her bed. Her parents in a rare heated argument. Her father was fighting to take Ruth to the hospital while her mother pleaded to keep her at home.
"If you don't let her go, she will die," she heard her father say.
Umakichi prevailed. Ruth was admitted. The family was placed under quarantine. As a toddler on a hospital ward, the lonely, frightened 3-year-old wept for her father's visits. He promised to bring her home when her fever broke, but the recovery was slow. After 2 weeks and a cloying hospital diet of stewed prunes, Ruth was finally strong enough to leave. The ordeal impressed upon her that life is short and time too precious to waste, she would say. In a school essay, she later crafted a happy ending to the terrifying episode. Fortunately, Father drove me home from the hospital in our very best Model T in time for Christmas. All I could remember was a beautiful doll and a tree that touched the ceiling. For most of her life, Ruth remained sturdy and robust, and the shadow of life-threatening disease passed over her, not to return for more than half a century. In March of 1933, when Ruth was 7 years old, Los Angeles was jolted by a violent earthquake that rocked the farmhouse, making its timbers lurch and groan. Ruth clung to the wooden beams for a long half minute until the shaking subsided. Haru regaled the family with stories of epic earthquakes in Japan, when yawning crevices opened and swallowed people whole. Farm life held all manner of dangers for all children in the pre-war years. Not just illness or natural disaster, but also poverty, farm equipment, and open fires. Ruth once saw her older sister Lois scalded by boiling water. After drifting in and out of consciousness, Lois told her little sister that she dreamed a friendly man with a long white beard in a horse-drawn chariot came for her, but she refused to go because she heard her mother calling. Lois recovered from her burns, but that vision lived in Ruth's memory. When Lois died later in old age, Ruth wrote to her sister's son, saying Lois's sense of adventure gave her strength and dispelled her fear of death. "Maybe," she wrote, "the bearded charioteer had returned for Lois at last." Home canning by thrifty farm families also held hazards. From a bumper crop of tomatoes, the Asawa once cooked up jars of homemade ketchup that went bad, swelling under pressure. The jars exploded, shattering glass in a shower of red sauce. But the family didn't quit canning. They learned from the misadventure, sweeping up the shards and splatter and cooking up another batch. "Crying doesn't help," Ruth would tell her friends. Ruth worked to live and lived to draw. When she wasn't in the fields or bent over her homework, she delighted in sketching the cartoon characters Blondie, Flash Gordon, Little Orphan Annie, and the Cats and Jammer Kids. She discovered Norman Rockwell and drew 1930s child stars like the blonde Shirley Temple and brunette Deanna Durbin. Encouraged by her art teachers, Gwendolyn Cohen and Edith Lowe, she drew polar bears lit by the aurora borealis. In the eighth grade, Ruth won a prize for her design of a patriotic poster of the Statue of Liberty against a red background. Her reception of the award was the only occasion Ruth remembered that her shy and hardworking parents visited the school. Teachers were free with discipline and parsimonious with praise. Miss Cohen rapped unruly boys with a ruler so hard that it broke, provoking howls of laughter from the class that reduced the teacher to tears of frustration. Ruth was impressed that Miss Cohen cared so much about her craft. Miss Lowe tartly remarked that Ruth's bold originality and abstract studies was marred by a certain lack of neatness. This theme would later be picked up by the most revered teacher of her life. But Ruth was undaunted. By age 10, she was sure she wanted to be an artist. Ruth kept an indelible memory of those farm wagon rides, dragging her feet and carving traceries in the dirt with her toes, weaving a trail of curved lines in the wake of dust between wheel tracks. Those shapes would resurface in the undulating forms of her wire sculptures. Crafting beauty from cast-off materials, a byproduct of scarcity, was another lifelong habit. As a little girl, Ruth would unwind the fine wires used to bundle vegetables and refashion them into bracelets and rings, studding them with a red bead she imagined as a ruby. She reveled in found objects, scrounging supplies and recycling trash into treasures. Despite the austerity of their lives in America, the Asawas preserved the culture they had left behind. The family spoke Japanese at home. Umakichi learned enough English to conduct his business, but Haru never did. Ruth Aiko learned English when she entered grammar school, where teachers insisted she assimilate and be called simply Ruth. On Saturday, the Asawas sent their children to study at the gakuen, or Japanese school. The Saturday ritual began with Lois honking the horn of the family's old gray Plymouth sedan, calling all the children to pile in for the drive to lessons. Language was taught by a stern sensei. If Ruth drifted off, he brought down a stick on the table with a sharp smack. The children were caught between linguistic tradition and pressure to speak English in school. The part of Saturday school Ruth loved best was calligraphy, learning to create Japanese characters and designs. It took exquisite arm control to sweep the brush from one stroke to the next, balancing the lines and, equally important, the spaces in between the lines. The Asawa children also got a chance to spend time in Japan studying with relatives. But when Ruth's turn came, her host uncle fell ill, so her journey was postponed. By the next opportunity, she had outgrown the kimonos sewn especially to wear on her trip. It was then 1939, and she was looking forward to high school. So her younger sister, Kimiko, went to Japan in her place, accompanied by older sister, Lois. From such trips, the children brought back art and dolls, ikebana flower arranging books, and treasures that preserved a touch of tradition in their farmhouse. They didn't know yet that keeping up their culture carried a cost, that respecting their heritage would mark them as alien enemies, or that children educated abroad, known as kibei, would face special scrutiny. They didn't know that rising tensions in autumn 1941 would find Lois boarding the last boat home before Pearl Harbor. They didn't know that Kimiko's widowed aunt would keep her in Japan, helping fulfill civilian duties like smoothing the runways for a nearby kamikaze base. There was no question of what she wanted. Her longing for home was simply lost in the fog of war. As she later reflected, people do not understand what it was like. Compared to farm chores, school seemed like playtime. No one wanted to get sick because sick days didn't spare you from housework. Ruth was studious, good in English, art, modern dance, and chorus, though less keen in social studies. She played shortstop on her school baseball team, even though she said she couldn't catch. She saved stacks of her school memorabilia, artwork from class, and programs from Christmas concerts and a school operetta in which she was cast as a dancing gypsy. She packed away issues of the National School Newspaper, a student tabloid that briefed students about Washington politics. More and more, it featured stories about rising tensions between the still-neutral U.S. government and rising militants in Germany and Italy. An ominous headline read, "President Warns Against Dictators." She penciled Ruth Asawa in cursive at the top of each front page and saved sheets that grew crisp and yellow, a time capsule of her early life. Through middle school, Ruth vowed a hatred of boys as strong as 10,000 octopus suckers. She softened after reading Longfellow's poem, The Courtship of Miles Standish, in which the outspoken Puritan girl Priscilla invites John Alden, her suitor's spokesman, to express his own affections with the famous line, "Why don't you speak for yourself, John?" That she liked. She soon experienced her first crush on a handsome blonde boy, discovering romance across color lines. Ruth was blossoming into adolescence with a strong will and a sure hand with a paintbrush. She helped look after her younger sisters and brother and obeyed Lois's stern directives at kendo practice, Japanese school, and homework time. The hardscrabble life afforded no frills, but growing up surrounded by six siblings set a view of family life and a vision for her future. However poor they might be, she would one day tell her future fiancé she wanted six children of her own. On her way to Excelsior Unified High School, Ruth walked her half mile and boarded the bus each day in her well-worn cotton dresses, waiting for the sensei's daughter, Alice Imamoto, to take the seat beside her. Together, they rode to high school as they had done since elementary school. The demure Alice was a piano prodigy, groomed by her scholarly parents to attend a music conservatory. She was 4 feet 8 inches tall, with tiny fingers that would match Mozart, but she lacked the handspan to play Rachmaninoff. She sat beside Ruth in art, admiring her friend's deft hand with drawing. Ruth was sturdier at 4 feet 11 inches. With her farm-bred work ethic and cartooning skill, Ruth's dream was to attend an art school. The heady hopes of 2 Japanese-American schoolgirls would soon be put on hold by World War II, politics, and the hatred unleashed on them by their fellow citizens. After February 1942, when the FBI arrested their father in his fields, the Asawa children interpreted wartime directives for their 50-year-old mother. Not knowing Umakichi's whereabouts, the family struggled to keep calm, go to school, and run the farm. Just as her mother's family had woven traditional silk kimonos from cocoons, Haru wove ancient cultural values into the fabric of Ruth's daily life. Ruth would say these traits were drilled into her. Gaman, endurance. Nintai, patience. Enyo, restraint. Shikataganai, it can't be helped. What can we do? What's done is done. Feisty by nature, Ruth strove to comport herself by these rules for life, whether in war or in peacetime, at home or at school, in the studio or out in society. Soon, the Asawa children stopped attending school to help with the farm. Then, in mid-April 1942, came the orders for all West Coast Japanese Americans to prepare to vacate their homes. Officials didn't spare orphans, including mixed-race infants with any Japanese blood, who were sent to the Children's Village, an orphanage at the camp in Manzanar, California. Notices of an impending roundup, which the government called an evacuation, appeared on walls and light posts around town. Under orders from the Western Defense Command and the Army's Wartime Civil Control Administration, all Japanese Americans were to pack bedding, toiletries, clothing, and dishes, limited to that which can be carried by the individual or family group. Families forced to sell their property got 10 cents on the dollar. Others stored belongings at neighbors' homes or churches, but such property often fell prey to looters. The Asawas left behind the farm with 4 workhorses, chickens, equipment, and trucks. They bid farewell to their mongrel dog, Butch, and abandoned the spring strawberries ripening in the field. Because of the Japanese farmers' bountiful harvests, historians note, agriculture lobbying groups admitted they weren't sorry to see their rivals go. Along with the government orders, homemade signs sprouted up, reviling neighbors now labeled Japs. No one needed to come and arrest the Asawas. Like many families who obeyed orders, they formed a car caravan with their cousins from Norwalk and drove themselves to the designated assembly center, Santa Anita Racetrack. This was one of the regional holding areas set up while permanent detention camps were under construction across the country. Ruth recalled the scramble to leave and the degrees of shock at what was in store. April 14th was the last day in Norwalk, my hometown. Before that day, I shopped madly all over town to find boots, stockings, and heavy clothing, for I was preparing to go to Manzanar. Then our notice came to leave on April 14th for Santa Anita, the greatest racetrack in the world. With tear-drenched eyes, I said goodbye to my friends. When we entered the Baldwin Gate at Santa Anita, I was happy to see white barracks, thinking I would live in one. We passed those, finding they were for the army. Then I saw black barracks. This time I was surely happy, confident of making this my new home. And what do you think I landed in? A horse stable. The palm tree-lined racetrack, once the turf for thoroughbreds like Seabiscuit and Manowar, sheltered nearly half of its 18,000 inmates in barracks in the infield and parking lot. less fortunate families, like the Asawas, were assigned to horse stables, converted for human habitation with a quick coat of whitewash and a linoleum patch over the stall's dirt floors, a slapdash remodeling that failed to block the stench. Hairs from the horse's mane and tail were stuck between cracks of the walls. The heat of summer accentuated the odor of recent tenants. To say accommodations were austere would be an understatement. Families had to stuff their mattress ticking with straw for their beds. The Asawas were issued cursory health checks, assigned numbers, and given color-coded buttons assigning them to the red mess hall beneath the grandstands. Toilets were about a block and a half away. Until 1942, only 150 showers were available for the 18,000 internees. Later, six more shower buildings, with 75 shower heads each, improved the ratio to one shower for every 30 inmates, still below the camp average. A central laundry was outdoors under a canopy, where rows of tubs with metal washboards thrummed into the night as thousands tried to scrub away the animal odor. Mess halls assaulted body and soul. The mass feeding stations fractured families. Menu staples included SOS, generic meat and gravy on bread, which soldiers called shit on a shingle. Worse was the mess hall habit of transforming today's starch into tomorrow's dessert, an affront to Japanese palates that left Ruth with a lifelong aversion. Two of the worst things that happened to us were the erosion of the family, noticed especially at mealtime. Young teenagers would go off to eat with new friends they had made. Parents lost control. The other terrible thing was serving us rice pudding. Rice with sugar, raisins, and milk. Every day there was rice or bread pudding made from leftover bread and rice. Official visitors came to inspect the center, including Director of the War Relocation Authority, Milton Eisenhower, the brother of future President General Dwight D. Eisenhower. On those days, Ruth saw administrators and their guests tuck into steak, French fries, and ice cream. "The eyes of the nation are upon us," reported the Santa Anita Pacemaker newsletter. Written by inmates, but controlled by the authorities, the paper likened the life of inmates to that of hardy pioneers in a frontier boomtown. It mingled upbeat notices for classes and recreation with draconian rules for inmate conduct. Collecting another person's mail, for example, was punishable with jail time or fines. Contraband items included knives, cameras, and even radios. Putting a good face on prison conditions was the newsletter's agenda. Inmates could play Twilight softball games at the Anita Chiquita Field, or dance to an Asian band named Japanita Jive. Film fare included The Gang's All Here and Oswald Rabbit for children. Talent shows and maypole dances were offered to divert and pacify. The Asawa family left their double horse stall during the day to breathe as much fresh air as possible, returning to sleep. Ruth attended class and occasionally took in a talent show. Her friend Alice was so fearful of getting lost, she didn't venture from her family stall. Freedom of religion, guaranteed by the wartime Civil Control Administration, encouraged displays of piety rarely seen at a racetrack. Six worship services a week included Seventh-day Adventists, Catholics, the Friends Church of Norwalk, two Protestant congregations, and one Buddhist group. White and Asian clergy presided.
"You will have time to rethink the foundation of your faith in Christendom," the pacemaker reported, Dr. E.C. Farnham of the Los Angeles Church Federation lecturing to young Japanese.
He called Santa Anita
a good laboratory in which experiments may be made in the study of sociology and psychology.
The goal of such an experiment wasn't disclosed. The U.S. Army put inmates to work at rates of $8, $12, and $16 a month for unskilled, skilled, and professional labor, respectively. The mess hall, maintenance division, and medical division also employed workers. What Santa Anita wasn't prepared for was the proper schooling of youth among the 18,719 people confined at the racetrack. College students like Lois volunteered in the classrooms to teach younger children, who could choose between going to school or work. Meanwhile, Ruth climbed to the highest row of seats in the Santa Anita grandstand, where her class met. There, she took in a sweeping view of the racetrack settlement, including a group of inmates who chose a work detail weaving camouflage nets to assist the war effort in the Pacific. One day, the squalor of the stables was briefly eclipsed by a stroke of movie magic. Three Japanese-American artists from Disney Studios arrived as internees at Santa Anita. The artists were veterans of animated features like Snow White and Pinocchio. Tom Okamoto, Chris Ishii, and James Tanaka offered to teach drawing and perspective to students held at the racetrack. Ruth jumped at the chance. She regarded Okamoto in particular as an early mentor. How lucky could a 16-year-old be to study for the first time with professional artists? They were generous with their time and supplied us with paper, charcoal, pencils, and ink. The artists also penned a cartoon strip mascot in the pacemaker called Little Nebo, short for Little Nisei Boy. The character was a rascal who made wisecracks about camp life as a safety valve for the indignities of incarceration. Nebo got transferred with his creator, Chris Ishii, to a permanent facility at Camp Granada, also known as Amachi, Colorado. When federal officials saw Ishii's talent, they recruited him to make propaganda posters and sent him to Shanghai. By then, Nebo was so popular in Colorado, other inmates carried on the cartoon strip. Yet for Ishii, Santa Anita was a way station en route to camp, and art class came to an end. Resentment mounted at Santa Anita over oppressive living conditions, herd-like feeding, remote toilets, and intrusive searches for contraband. Police, suspecting the presence of contraband articles, rummaged through inmates' meager belongings. Their rough searches provoked charges of jewelry theft. Suspecting the raids were sparked by tips from Asian American spies in their midst, inmates became furious. In August 1942, a riot erupted that ended in the severe beating of a suspected informant. Jeeps roared up to the Santa Anita gates to quell the disturbance. A curfew came down, and people were confined to their stalls without dinner. 3 days of martial law cooled the rebellion. Ruth, like many, suspected officials enlisted Japanese Americans or other Asian Americans who understood the Japanese language to inform on them. We all knew that, imagined or not, each block had a paid spy, Inu, dog. In September 1942, after half a year in the horse stalls, the Asawas and other Japanese American families got word they were to be moved inland. They would board trains to one of 10 permanent relocation centers, Manzanar and Tule Lake, California, Gila River and Poston, Arizona, Minidoka, Idaho, Topaz, Utah, Heart Mountain, Wyoming, Granada, Amachi, Colorado, and Jerome and Rower, Arkansas. They were the concentration camps Washington had foreseen even before Pearl Harbor, set on remote wastelands far from coastal military zones. It must have been near September 15th when our notice for the relocation center came. We started packing everything as before, only on a smaller scale. Our last Caucasian friends came to visit us. I couldn't imagine how far we were going from there, or for how long. Photographs of mass transport show Japanese American families crowding the train platform dressed in their best. Men wore suits, or what would have been called Eisenhower jackets, with snap brim hats. Women wore modish print dresses and heels, their hair curled under hats, turbans, or snoods. In one hand, they gripped hat boxes, suitcases, and bundles, while the other clasped children in sailor suits or Superman t-shirts, clutching a toy or doll. From their smart attire, they might have been setting off for a holiday or a family reunion. But despite a mask of composure, Their faces looked ashen and strained. Ruth's excitement about taking her first train ride vanished when she saw the dilapidated rail cars. All available modern rolling stock had been requisitioned for the war effort, leaving only antique trains with gas lights and wooden bench seats. As the train left Los Angeles, Ruth saw Norwalk receding in the distance. Dim, hot, and crowded, the cars teemed with passengers jostling in the aisles. Rocking on the rails left Ruth's mother nauseated from motion sickness. People slept in their clothes, sitting up or lying on the floor, hoping not to be trampled. They lined up at the tiny washrooms to brush their teeth and wash their faces. With windows shut to keep out the soot, the close heat left bodies sticky. Shades were drawn shut, which had several effects. It observed the blackout, hid the identity of the passengers from curious locals at the stations they passed, obscured the landscape, and concealed their route. Cutting off the view also kept riders from seeing the horizon line, disorienting their senses and provoking motion sickness among many in the lurching cars. A young public health physician riding the trains, Dr. Harold B. Alexander, befriended the Asawas. The quiet, industrious Japanese teenager he saw bustling about, helping car monitors watch children and feed babies, impressed the young ophthalmologist. He remembered the name Ruth Asawa, following her future fortunes and corresponding with her for decades. After working with the monitors, Ruth felt relief as she went to the dining cars, where she found the black porters to be friendly. She heard fellow passengers passing the time by singing folk songs. After sundown, she ventured a glance out the windows of the moving train, making mental sketches of the changing landscape that flashed by as she sped toward her unknown destination. It was near nightfall when I saw the first glimpse of California desert. Needles, Arizona, was our first stop after California. A few minutes out of Needles, with the moon above, the Colorado River wound its way around and under us. Passing through New Mexico, with its Indians, I first noticed the sharp distinction of the colored and white. Houston, Texas, was the largest city in which we stopped and conversed with a carload of Army men. We sang Pearl Harbor with them. The Louisiana swamps were just as I imagined them to be, enchanting, beautiful, and weird. After 4 days, the vintage engine slowed near McGee, Arkansas, a small country town with dirt and gravel roads near the state's southeastern border with Louisiana. The cars creaked to a stop at a raw outpost, which evacuees learned was their new home. Ruth saw an old barn and fields surrounded on three sides by trees.
"Rower, get ready to leave,"
a soldier barked, moving through the train. They had arrived in Rower Relocation Center, about 110 miles from Little Rock. Along with the neighboring site in Jerome, where Ruth's friend Alice was headed, the two Arkansas outposts were set in Jim Crow South, the farthest camps from home. Gathering up their children and bundles, a few older Issei picked up garbage on their way out and deposited it in the trash bins. Old courtesies died hard, even when going to prison. Passengers boarded trucks for the 12-mile ride to the camp. Audible groans arose when they saw the tar-paper-clad barracks of their new home with its barbed wire perimeter. Flanked by cotton fields and woods, the settlement at least wasn't a desert, one optimist observed. Outside the barbed wire, Ruth saw the haunting shapes of cypress hung with moss. As she set foot onto the ochre-yellow soil, a gust of wind kicked up dust. Inhaling the humid bayou heat of September 1942, she began her year of wartime exile in its dismal, spooky air. Chapter 2, The Camp. Weary families with children and battered suitcases piled out of the trucks onto the dry, weedy ground. The gates to the rower camp were grimmer than the palm-lined entrance to Santa Anita, but at least the shelters didn't reek of horses. Inside the 10,000-acre site were 500 acres, were almost 1 square mile of barracks, divided into blocks. They were built over old cornfields and wetlands under supervision of the Army Corps of Engineers at a cost of $4.8 million. The barbed wire fence was studded with 8 towers, each manned by armed guards. The arrival of the Japanese Americans turned Rower Relocation Center into Arkansas's 6th largest city. Its capacity was nearly 9,000 inmates, and almost 12,000 would pass through its gates between 1942 and 1945. Arkansas Governor Homer Adkins, a one-time member of the Ku Klux Klan, resisted the placement of Japanese Americans in his state, but agreed when told the inmates would be held by armed white guards. The camp's entrance was flanked by the military police headquarters, warehouses, motor pool, and administrators' apartments. On the northern side of camp were a cannery and hospital. In the central core were schools, a water tank and fire station, an auditorium and library, and an athletic field. Still raw and unfurnished, the camp took months to install equipment such as school chairs. Looming towers raked the night sky with spotlights. Ruth, like other people, saw through the cover story that the guards were there to protect the Japanese Americans. If so, then why did the guards point their guns inward toward the inmates? Outside the barbed wire perimeter, the bayous were thick with overhanging cypress trees. Swamps and creeks were alive with poisonous cottonmouth snakes and razor-toothed gator fish, making escape a dangerous dream. 2 youths wandered away one night, but were apprehended on the interstate and held overnight in jail before being returned to camp with their heads shaven. Prisoners could leave camp only with permission or when their work detail required it. Even then, unaccustomed sight of a Japanese American outside the fence could ignite unpredictable reactions. One day, a local man from the backwoods was out hunting wild turkey when he spied a group of prisoners surveying land. Thinking them escapees, the hunter yelled, "Jap!" and fired his shotgun, emptying a load of pellets into the backside of a fleeing prisoner. "It hurt like hell, but I wasn't about to stop. I kept running," said the victim, who had the pellets extracted at the camp hospital. Tropical weather and critters were a misery. Rains liquefied the Arkansas soil into a soupy gumbo mud that sucked at shoes. Humid heat bred swarms of mosquitoes, and there was a shortage of quinine for treatment. Chiggers flourished in the camp too, burrowing into the skin, causing intense itching. Sufferers would light matches and get burned while trying to draw the insects out. Some folks, it was believed, took up smoking just to rout the bugs. Fall brought sandstorms, winter, icicles. Transplanted Californians.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.